Welcome, listeners, to a special edition of Trend Talks. I'm Deborah Gatt. Joining me today is Andrea Amatuzio, anti-financial crimes leader from PwC Italy, and together we'll be navigating through the fog of sanctions. Hello, Andrea.
Deborah, thank you very much for having me.
So, the topic today is sanctions. We've heard about sanctions since the beginning of the year. It's a topic which took center stage in our daily operations. But can I start off with the first question to you, Andrea? Can you, in layman terms, try to explain what sanctions are and what is this big fuss about sanctions?
Deborah, thank you for starting with a tough question. Sanctions are overall understood as means of national security and a way at an international level to restore political order. So we have sanctions that are managed and issued by international organizations like the UN under Chapter 7. We have supranational sanctions, like, for example, the one issued and administered by the European Union. And then we have sanctions that are a prerogative of sovereign states. For example, the UK, or the most famous one is the US sanction regime. That's where we change the perspective from a way to restore international political order into sovereign national security.
I know I started off with a tough question, and thank you for trying to simplify what sanctions are. Historically, we've been looking at sanctions and considering that sanctions are something that apply to financial institutions, to banks that are processing payments. Is that where the extent of sanctions ends or stops? Is it just the banks that they are obliged to follow sanctions issued, or it extends beyond banks?
Great point. Let me give you a four quadrant perspective on this. The short answer to your question is, not only financial institutions, so banks or insurances, are obliged to comply with applicable sanctions. Every subject that is regulated by either a international regime or it's regulated by a state-owned regime is subject to sanctions. So let's imagine a private company, an industrial company listed on a stock exchange. They are subject to the sanctions imposed by the relevant authorities of that state. That's the first element. So you have financial institutions and non-financial institutions. These days, the non-financial institutions are very much the center of the concern, but I think we're going to touch upon that later. The two quadrants are this. We have sanctions that are imposed and are mandatory for individuals or entities of one specific countries. For example, in the U.S., you have what are called the primary sanctions that apply to U.S. citizens, to U.S. corporations. But then you have a specific element of sanctions, which is called the secondary sanctions, which are often defined as a extraterritorial regime. So in this very complex, and then you have a couple of other types of sanctions. Nowadays, to make it very simplified, I would say that sanctions are for not only for banks, but also for non-financial institutions. They're not only the one applicable in one specific country, but you might have elements of extraterritoriality, which all make the landscape more complex to manage.
You mentioned if there is a company, an institution that is listed on a particular stock exchange, Is it only those entities that are listed on a stock exchange that need to give due regard to sanctions, or this extends also to other companies? Let's pick, for example, a normal business, an importer of goods who has been running his own business for the last 5, 10, 20 years. Is that person... should that person be concerned about sanctions, or at that point in time when he needs to effect any payments, then there are the banks that will deal with any screening that needs to be done?
You absolutely got the point. My reference to stock exchange was a oversimplification of the scenario. Sanctions apply to everyone that is involved in import, export, trading, finance, borrowing money, building something, exporting something. So this is for me to say the sanctions are a blanket that sits on top of everyone right now.
In simple language, it's applicable to every Tom, Dick, and Harry out there.
Yes, correct.
The straight, simple answer to that. So when we get a subject that is so complex, applicable to such a vast segment of society, what are the things, so if I am that businessman, what are the things that I should start acquainting myself with respect to sanctions?
The current situation, and by that mean I refer to clearly the Russian-Ukraine war, the tensions happening in Taiwan, the probably new round of sanctions against Iran. We need to consider both, we need to consider ourselves as both generator and receiver of sanctions risk, as banks or as industrial entities, or as you know, private sector, in whatever industry we are engaging to, we generate risk to our counterparts, and at the same time, we are subject to the risk of dealing with certain counterparts. So let's imagine, using your example before, you are import-export entity, you are dealing with a supplier from a risky country, so that's a risk that you need to mitigate, but at the same time you generate a level or a degree of risk for the financial institutions you have account with, or you have a letter of credit or a commercial relationship with.
So this is the reason why banks are increasing their due diligence, the questions they are asking about companies, about businesses, wanting to know with whom the counterparties, the stakeholders, the other stakeholders will be, where am I likely to get or receive payments from in terms of entities, jurisdictions. So this is what's generating all these questions to maintain a banking relationship.
Yes, this is what we see right now. What you just mentioned is one of the most interesting and impacting changes in the last few months. Let's start from financial institutions. We see more and more often financial institutions asking to their clients, what is that transaction about? Why you are exporting certain materials to a determined, to a specific country? Is that material containing products of U.S. origin, for example? Is the product that you're selling being able to be sold again to a third country? So more than ever, we see an overlap between export limitations, so trade compliance and sanctions. And on the other side, on the industrial side, more and more often, institutions are, industrial entities are creating and adopting what we define as an internal compliance program, a trade compliance program, they will allow them to go to banks or other counterparties to say, hey, I'm a reputable subject for you to deal with.
It's Sod's law. These questions many times come in when timing is against an individual. So, for example, there's a shipment which needs to be released, a payment has to go through, and the bank is asking 1,000 questions, some of which are what you've just mentioned. Is there anything that that businessman can do to preempt and prevent the bank asking the questions at a time which is not maybe opportune or ideal?
It takes a nice leap of willingness to move into the correct scenario. Let me expand on that. Many corporations have always said, especially like tier two or tier three, I'm gonna deal with something only and if I have to. Well, right now it's the time when it's important for financial, for industrial entities to create that compliance program. It's important for them right now to understand the risk that they have in the morning when they open shop. It's important for them to be the reputable counterparts for financial institutions. It's no longer the time to say, I'm going to wait until something happens, or even worse, until they catch me. At that point, when the climate and the sanction landscape that we are right now, it's too late.
So prevention, as they say, it's always better than cure. And this is, if I'm understanding you correctly, what you are explaining in terms of preempting those questions by banks, maybe even approaching them and asking what is the actual information they are after. You were asking about suppliers, details of origin of the product, for example. So you mentioned the word compliance program. Compliance program is something which is associated with regulated entities. And here we are discussing the businesses out there, the day-to-day establishments. So really we're entering into a new space here where the supermarket around the corner has to start dealing with a new regime, which is completely alien to these people, because they understand their business, but they don't understand or have never dealt with compliance before.
You're absolutely correct. You're absolutely correct. And I know that might sound too much or preaching for something that it's detached from reality. But let me tell you, the Russian-Ukraine sanctions really have opened a Pandora's box in terms of the importance for industrial entities, for the business, to understand the inherent risk that they're running with every morning. They need to understand their counterparts, they need to understand their suppliers, the agent, the distributors in the different regions where they operate, because they might now want to break or violate sanctions, but someone on their behalf might be doing it. Someone that they do business with, they might violate sanctions. Someone might resell their products to a militia, you know, in some parts of the world. That's the concern that I'm trying to stress every time that I talk to clients.
So you're mentioning and talking about this risk. So even if I am that businessman importing products, if I don't do certain homework myself, not to use bombastic words like due diligence, so if I don't do certain homework myself, I could be in breach of sanctions without even knowing?
Yes, absolutely.
And absolutely. The repercussions for that?
They go from maybe your suppliers or your distributors not wanting to work with you anymore, to the most extreme consequence, which may be listed by a sovereign state in a sanction list. So imagine you are Maltese company that, you know, exports computers with a U.S. component there, like Windows or another operating program, that, and then you send that computer to Russia, and that computer is used to control a attack somewhere. That's what's going to happen if the U.S. authorities will find out. They might put that entity on a sanction list, and you are done. No bank will touch you. You will be a pariah in the trade war.
Wow, that is really serious.
It's really serious.
It's really serious.
We have seen a number of entities completely going bankrupt because they were violating, knowingly or not knowingly, U.S. sanctions or European sanctions.
Andrea, I know we've touched on a very complex subject and time is against us. But in these few minutes, I think you've managed to help us understand a little bit more what sanctions are to the men in the street out there. And hopefully this information will help our listeners to seek more information, because I'm sure we can't deliver all the necessary elements here, but the element of raising awareness, being aware of what you're dealing with and with whom, and having the answers to questions that are bound to come their way at some point in time by banks.
There is a way of saying in the world of sanctions, there are 9 billion reasons to worry about sanctions, because the highest fine paid for a sanction violation was $9 billion. Having doubts and asking questions is the first step toward making it right.
Andrea, I thank you very much for your insights. It's been a pleasure having you here with us today.
Thank you, Deborah.
You're welcome. Thank you to our listeners for tuning in.